Hello again. Today we move to the last topic in Chapter 8, Reduced Instruction Set Computer, RISC. In the previous videos, we discussed general register organization, stack organization, instruction formats, addressing modes, data transfer and manipulation, and in the last video, we discussed program control. An important aspect of computer architecture is the design of the instruction set for the processor. The instruction set chosen for a particular computer determines the way that machine language programs are constructed. Early systems had a small and simple instruction set. And this is because of the cost of the hardware. In the early systems, the cost of hardware was very high. But it has decreased with the advent of integrated circuits. And here there was a trend to increase the instruction set, and the number of instructions ranges from 100 to 200 and even more. And these computers had a variety of data types and addressing modes. A computer with a large number of instructions is classified as a complex instruction set computer, abbreviated as CISC. In the early 1980s, a number of designers recommended that computers use fewer instructions with simple constructs so they can be executed much faster within the CPU and with less references to memory. This type is classified as reduced instruction set computers, abbreviated RISC. The major characteristics of CISC architectures are a large number of instructions, usually more than 100 instructions, some special purpose instructions are used infrequently. In CISC computers, we have a large variety of addressing modes, from 5 to 20 different modes. The instruction format is variable. Some instructions requires, for example, only 2 bytes, like register reference instructions, and others may need 4 or even more bytes. And we have instructions that manipulate operands in memory. The concept of RISC involves an attempt to reduce execution time by simplifying the instruction set of the computer. The major characteristics of a RISC processor are relatively few instructions, few addressing modes, memory access limited to load and store instructions, and all the operations are performed within the CPU registers. And this is because in the RISC machines, we have a large number of registers in the CPU, so we can store the operands, the intermediate results in the CPU registers and do not need to access memory every time. Fixed length, easily decoded instruction, single instruction cycle execution, and in order to achieve high speed, the control in RISC computers is hardware rather than macro programmed. Next, overlapped register windows. Procedure call and retain occurs quite often in high-level programming languages. When translated into machine language, a procedure call produces a sequence of instructions that save register values, pass parameters needed for the procedure, and then calls a subroutine to execute the body of the procedure. After a procedure retain, the program restores the old register values, passes results to the calling program, and retains it from the subroutine. The process of saving and passing parameters here, and restoring and passing results here, is time consuming. Some computers provide multiple register banks, and each procedure is allocated its own bank of registers. This eliminates the need for saving and restoring register values. A characteristic of some RISC processors is their use of overlapped register windows to provide the passing of parameters and avoid the need for saving and restoring register values. Each procedure call results in the allocation of a new window consisting of a set of registers from the register file for use by the new procedure. Each procedure call activates a new register window by incrementing a pointer, while the return statement decrements the pointer and causes the activation of the previous window. Windows for adjacent procedures have overlapping registers that are shared to provide the passing of parameters and results. Here we have an example of overlapped register windows. The system has a total of 74 registers. 10 registers are global. Here R0 through R9. They are common to all procedures, and they are used to all parameters shared by the procedures. The other 64 registers are divided into four windows to accommodate procedures A, B, C, and D. Each register window consists of 10 local registers. For example, this register is local for A, this local for B, this local for C, and this local for D. And we have two sets of six registers common to adjacent windows. For example, these six registers and these six registers are adjacent to C. These six and these six are adjacent to B. Do you see this set and this set is the same? They are common to A and D. Local registers are used for local variables and parameters, and common registers are used to exchange parameters and results between the adjacent procedures. If the number of global registers is G and the number of local registers in each window is L, and the number of registers common to two windows is C, and the number of windows is W, then the number of registers available for each window is calculated as follows. Window size equals L plus 2C plus G. And the total number of registers needed in the processor or the register file equals to L plus C multiplied by W plus G. Now, our example, the global registers are 10. The local registers are also 10. Number of registers common to two windows here is 6, and number of windows is 4. So the window size equals to 10 plus 2 multiplied by 6 plus 10, which is 32 registers. And the register file equals to 10 plus 6 multiplied by 4 plus 10, which is 74 registers. Suppose, for example, we need to design a system with 3 windows and 12 registers in each window and 8 common registers adjacent to 2 windows. And suppose that we need 16 global registers. You can calculate using the formulas, but I would like to calculate in another way. Since we have 3 windows, then for the A procedure, we need here 12 local registers and 8 common with B. And for the B procedure, we need 12 registers and 8 common to C. And for the C procedure, we need 12 and 8 common to A. In addition to that, we need 16 global registers. The window size equals, for example, for A, we have here these 12 registers, and here this 8, and here this 8. So 12 plus 8 adjacent to B and 8 adjacent to C, plus the 16 global registers, which is equals 20, 36, 44 registers. And the total register file equals to here 12 plus 8, 20 multiplied by 360 plus 16 global, which is 76 registers. And you can compute these values using the formulas and compare the results. This was the last section in chapter 8 for today. That's all. Thank you.